I'd like to preach to you the right thing to brag about. The right thing to brag about. I'm going to give you an opportunity to brag tonight a little bit. Turn in your Bibles, please, to the book of Galatians. Tonight is a historic night at Lighthouse. A couple cool things happening. We are enjoying both or celebrating both of the ordinances of the Lord's table and baptism tonight. That's what in the world should church be doing? That's a good thing to be doing, right? But also, we will finish another book of the Bible. And I don't know how you feel about that. I keep trying to get you excited about that. I always feel a sense of accomplishment in our church when we do this because we have been carefully ingesting an entire book of the Bible in context, the way that God sees it, the way that God wrote it, you know, his exact, you know, we're seeing, you know, the context flow along. Always think, you know, it's just kind of crazy to cherry pick, to preach by cherry picking, and there's times for topical messages, but there's, you know, you wouldn't take a love letter that you got from your sweetheart, and you pull out a sentence here, and pull out a sentence here, and pull out a sentence here, and say, look at this. No, it's all in context. It's all, you know, one thought builds one another. That's the purest way, the purest practice of hearing the Word of God, is just moving through it in the very context, in the very paragraphs how God wrote it. The theme of Galatians has been a treaty of sorts about both what is the absolute gospel that reconciles man to God, and then after a man comes to Christ as Savior, how he lives that out, how he lives. That is sanctification, like we saw this morning. So it is about this absolute gospel, no other way. And really explaining and arguing and fighting against anything that would make itself a warped gospel to us, an additive gospel to us, and even how it creeps in the way that once we're saved, how we live for Jesus after we're saved. So let's have a word of prayer, and we'll get back to it. We'll finish the book of Galatians, Lord willing, tonight. Thank you, Lord, for this great book. Thank you, Lord, for how clear it is. Lord, it was almost like preaching through here that Paul was going to jump up out of the page and grab us by the neck and tell us, you just got to believe in Jesus alone. Stop adding something. And I thank you for it. I thank you for your precious word. I thank you for the celebration around the King's table tonight. Lord, your cross is everything. We have nothing without it. We have everything with it. And I pray, Lord, please feed your people tonight the living word. In Jesus' name, amen. The gospel sprung up as it was first given by Christ and carried by his apostles in mostly Jewish areas. Sprung up in Jewish areas around the known world. And the early fight with this idea of a pure gospel was if the gospel of Jesus Christ alone saves. Or should Jewish tradition be added to that? Is Christ enough? Is this new covenant enough? Is what Christ did by his cross and resurrection enough? And of course, it was a huge argument, and there were some that said no. This group, called the Judaizers, were a group of zealots that were almost like missionaries that went out of Jerusalem to the early churches around the known world, preaching that new believers had to continue in the teachings and the acts of Moses' law in order to be saved, in order to live out their sanctification. They needed to add the law to Christ. Now, that may not seem like, you know, viable at all to us, but think about how many books of our New Testament that is covered. And the argument for just a pure resting upon Christ and Christ only, it's a hugely important area to understand, and we'll have application to it to our own church here tonight. But they said that you had to continue in the things in order to really be reconciled to God, to be saved, and to be practicing salvation the right way. You had to continue, for instance, your children, whatever, those coming, those non-Jews coming to Christ had to be circumcised, you know, or they weren't really saved. You had to continue the dietary restrictions, that is, eating certain foods, and like a Jew, resisting certain foods, and separating from different things, all kinds of things that had to do with clothing and the way you did things in the course of a week. Keeping the Sabbath day and holy days and these kind of things. And all of it, the heart of it all was being an external religion of doing certain acts to please God with your body, with your flesh. All of it was focused on, if I do this, and if I do this, I do this, God will be pleased with me. And even after the idea of someone coming to Christ, it was that external kind of sanctification that was all based on, if you do this and punch your card and you do this, then God will accept you and you'll be a good Christian or whatever. The book of Galatians vehemently preaches Christ alone. So turn there to the last paragraph of the book, Galatians chapter 6, beginning of verse number 11 through the end of the book. Would you stand, please, as we preach this last paragraph and then the closing. Beginning of verse number 11, Galatians chapter 6, verse number 11. Ye see how large a letter I have written unto you with mine own hand. Well, wait a minute, Paul. That's not a very large letter. It's only six chapters. We'll get there at the end. We'll explain that. As many as desire to make a fair show in the flesh or in their body, they constrain you to be circumcised, only lest they should suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. For neither they themselves who are circumcised keep the law, but desire to have you circumcised that they may glory in your flesh, or what you're doing in your body, externals. But God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creature. And let me just say that this way, but being born again, becoming a new creature, that's what matters. A salvation, a gospel that can do that, not you living some external. And as many as walk according to this rule, what rule? What he just said. Peace be on them and mercy and upon the Israel of God. From henceforth, let no man trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. Brethren, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen. You may be seated. Verse 11, large letter, is just a translation statement to really the end paragraph of the book. But notice that it may give a little bit insight about what Paul's medical thorn in the flesh was. It possibly could, this statement here. He is saying in this verse that he talks about how large a letter. Look at verse 11. You see how large a letter I have written unto you with mine own hand. I kind of like made a little note so that you would remember that Paul, it's only six chapters long. Okay, they didn't have chapter division. He just wrote this letter. But it's not a long letter. What does he mean? Well, he is talking about the actual manuscript that he is writing, this actual physical letter that he is writing. And really, we would call that the autograph, that original, before any copies were made for other churches, that original letter is written by him in very big font. Very big letters, literally. You see these big letters that I've written to you. Many believe that this is a clue that his thorn in the flesh was actually his eyesight. And he was writing in these big letters, the book of Galatians, because it was continually deteriorating, something in his eyesight. We don't know, but it's a good guess. So he transitions from verse number 11 into verse number 12. And listen as we begin the last argument in the book of Galatians against external religion. Point number one tonight, the wrong boast in our Christian lives. The wrong boast, or the wrong thing to brag about. Verse 12 and 13 says it this way, as many as desire to make a fair show in the flesh, they constrain you to be circumcised, only lest they should suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. For neither they themselves who are circumcised keep the law. Okay, he's saying that they're just a bunch of hypocrites. They don't keep the law, but desire to have you circumcised that they may glory in your flesh, or glory in some external thing. These verses are revealing the wrong motives of those that put confidence, they boast, they brag about doing religious stuff in order, in their warped thinking, to be saved and to continue to please God in what they would call their Christian life. They are boasting in what they do in their bodies. They're boasting in them thinking that they are keeping this religious stuff and that God is pleased and that God will save them because of them, Rather, they're boasting in that, rather in the truth of what really saves a man. They're not boasting in the broken body and the blood of Christ and his resurrection. They're boasting in what they could do in their performance and their keeping of religion and them going down their check sheets of, you know, doing this, I do this, and I'm good, I do this, and I do this, and I do this, and I do this. Look at the wrong motive, the first wrong motive that is exposed in verse number 12. They think that the outward show is what salvation is and what sanctification is. The outward show. In fact, that word is used. Verse 12. As many as desire to make a fair show in the flesh. The words have tone. He is mocking them. As many as want to make a good show, or we would say, look good. We would say, put on a show. As many as do this, they're the ones that are interested in you Gentiles who come to Christ having to get circumcised, have to carry, you know, continue the law, have to not eat this, have to do this, have to don't do this. Notice the phrases of verse number 12, to make a fair show in the flesh. Verse 13 says it this way, that they may glory in your flesh, that they may brag, that they may boast in the fact that you're doing all these external things, that is, glory in what you do in your body. People who have this view of Christianity, and it's not something that just happened 2,000 years ago. This is a continual fight in Christianity. This is a continual fight in theology. It's a continual fight in sanctification. And people who have this view of Christianity are about all about doing things on the outside that they associate with being a good Christian or pleasing God. They measure themselves up and you up by seeing if you have done all these things on their list in a certain way, or if you conduct your outward life in a certain way. And it's almost as if they create their whole nother religion. They call it Christianity, but it's all about if you do their preferential soapbox exact thing of whether you are saved or whether you're living as a good Christian. All the emphasis is on externals, rather than the truth of what really saves a person. Rather than the truth of if this person has been made born again. Really, rather than the truth of what happened at the cross. It's not about Christ's cross that saves a person and keeps a person. It is completing a punch card of external things for show. The Holy Spirit picked tremendously clear words here when he says in verse 12, they want to make a fair show. It's all about what looks good to other people. It is all about the show. It is all about them acting. It is all about them doing the stuff on the outside for others to see, to satisfy and impress, and for others to think that they're spiritual because they do all the outward stuff that makes them saved and an acceptable Christian. In Paul's day, that was the things I've already told you. Continuing the externals of the Mosaic law. You know, circumcision. Oh, you got saved. So imagine, here's a guy, and you know, he has no connection. He's not Jewish at all. He hears the gospel of Jesus Christ in a different town, in a different country. And he trusts on Christ as his Savior, and he's baptized showing. And so these you know, zealots from Jerusalem come to his town and come, you know, into where he is worshiping, come and he's probably joining with a synagogue, or he's trying to join with those who believe on Jesus Christ. He says, oh, yeah, but you've got to be circumcised now. Oh, yeah, but you've got to keep Moses' law. You've got to do these dietary things. And he says, wait a minute, I'm trusting on Jesus Christ. Christ died for my sins. Isn't that what reconciles? Isn't that what man redeems? And that's what it's been preached to me. Oh, yeah, but you've got to do these things. It was all about the show. That idea of doing external things for the expectations of others to look spiritual really hasn't changed in our generation. And there is still a lot of religion and a lot of quote-unquote Christianity that works the same way. You do this, this, and this, and I'll say that you're probably saved. You do this, this, and this, and you're a good Christian. Concerning salvation, there are groups that focus on externals for salvation that would be those that would expect you to join their church and to do their rituals, to do their sacraments, in order to be saved. It's not about Christ alone. It's not about he sufficiently was our Lamb of God, the sacrifice for us. It's about if you are a part of my church. Amish, Catholics, Jehovah Witnesses, Mormons. If you do these things, these external things, if you join this, if you go along with this in our church, then you will be acceptable to God. That is pure Judaizing. That is unnecessary. Christ is enough, not these external things. Concerning sanctification, concerning growing in the Lord. Sometimes we as conservative believers, we kind of slip back into this. You know, our sufficiency stops being what Jesus Christ did on the cross and the great grace that has come to us, and we start thinking that we've got to work our way, that we've some kind of got to impress God by putting on external things. Well, concerning sanctification, it's not about the externals either. We should know this because of Christ's constant discussion in the Gospels about a man's heart. You know, it's not what goes into a man that defiles the man, it's what comes out of the man, his heart. Jesus is always dealing with your heart and the fact that you need a new heart and a born-again heart. He's always talking about internal things and us changing and being conformed to the image of himself, of Christ. He's not talking about do this, do this, do this outwardly. In fact, he really condemned that. He called that Pharisaicalism, whenever all the emphasis was on the outward. But it's about God changing our inner man by what happened at the cross. Our Christian growth is directly tied to the cross. The power to change, like we preached this morning, and put on those seven things, is directly tied to verse number 1-4 this morning, of what Jesus did for us at the cross. The power of our new man to be born again and then to live for the Lord is by the power of the cross. Sanctification is not doing external spiritual things to put on a show to please men. Look at what verse 13, the first part, says about these show religionists. It says, for neither they themselves who are circumcised keep the law. It's all a show. They don't obey God from the heart. They're not obeying God's laws from the heart, but desire to have you circumcised that they may glory in your flesh. What is crazy about these people is these Judaizers that were coming, they act like they love God, and they act like, you know, they were the answer, and you had to be saved and trust in Christ and then put on the Mosaic law. The verse number 13 exposes their heart. They don't want to love God and follow the Lord from their heart. They don't love him, wish to serve him. They've just latched onto these externals of the Mosaic law that they can get very militant about and demand that you do them and really practice their own kind of religion that is separate from the actual scriptures and actually what it means to be born again and to grow in the Lord. They've created almost a religion of their own. Oh, my dear church family, there are many professing believers, especially, that have created almost their own religion by exalting externals and preaching preferential soapboxes about how to please God. In our circles, it would not be so much about how to be saved. I think that is clear, but the sanctification gets kind of cloudy as this preacher and that preacher and this camp of Christianity and that camp of Christianity says you got to do this external and that external and this external and do this and do this and do this. It's always interesting to me among these Judaizers as well as those in Christian circles like I grew up with that emphasize the externals and standards and these kind of things, that the things that are emphasized as the most important were very little of the time even scriptural things or had their actual root in scripture or that anyone could actually turn to in a Bible and make any kind of valid case about why doing this is very important in Christian life. And why it seemed like every preacher was getting on up on a soapbox to preach that this is so important for men and women to do this and to do this and do this and do this, except it was not tethered in the Word. It was boasting in externals. Some of you know exactly what I'm saying. Paul argues that that is not something that saves a man, and after he comes to Christ, is not something that he continues in. Paul argues that is all about making a fair show in the flesh to please other people. That is about boasting in your performance and you doing something that is not really boasting in Jesus Christ. It's not boasting in what the Lord has done for you by salvation or by sanctification. And the Lord doesn't get the glory of all that. It's how much you can perform that gets the attention. Look at wrong motive number two. So the first wrong motive is making a fair show. Look at wrong motive number two in the passage that these Judaizers had. Last part of verse number 12. Only lest, so let me read the whole thing. As many as desire to make a fair show in the flesh, they constrain you to be circumcised. They want you to do these external things because it's all about the making a good show. Now look what the last part says. Only lest they should suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. Why were they so adamant about these externals? Why were they so adamant about preaching or adding to the gospel of Jesus Christ's cross alone? They were protecting their Jewish status that under the Roman Empire, living Judaism, living as a Jewish person, following the Mosaic law, was protected. But let me tell you what wasn't protected. Christians. True followers of the Lord Jesus Christ were persecuted. And these people, they wouldn't go out on a limb. They would not, as some of you know this reference, they wouldn't follow Jesus Christ outside the camp where they would be persecuted. Their religion went only, the Judaizers, as deep as saving their own skin. They didn't have any faith in salvation beyond what it would cost them. Let that sink way down deep inside of you tonight. And I would ask you, how deep does your religion run? Are you willing to be persecuted for following only, exclusively, the cross of Jesus Christ? Are you willing to be persecuted by Judaizing, legalizing Christians for following only what Christ taught us in Scripture instead of man-made externals? Is there anyone here with a backbone that would actually say in a group of those that were pushing externals, can you please refer me to where I can find that in my New Testament? Can you please refer me to where Christ said that that was important for salvation or sanctification instead of letting that kind of foolishness continue on? We say that this Bible is our sole authority for life and practice. Well, we better stop making it. We start making it so. And stop doing all the other things that are not emphasized in the precious Word of God. Get back to pure, absolute following of the Lord Jesus Christ and how He told us to worship Him. I want you to notice, secondly, tonight, the right boast. Okay, that's all the wrong boast. Here's the right boast. Verse number 14. Here's the right thing to brag in. Not in externals, not in adding externals, or which church does this external, or which girl or which woman or man does this external, whatever, to make themselves more pleasurable to God or a better Christian, whatever. But here's what you brag on. Verse 14, but God forbid that I should glory, there's our boast word, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creature, but being born again. That's what matters. The right boast. The word glory here in verse 14 means to brag about something, to boast in something, and the thinking is this. What am I really standing on? What am I really lifting up in my life? What do I really take stock in that saves me and forms my Christian practice of what I do from day to day? Is it performing externals that have, you know, far applications that are not close to the Word of God, but in my church or in my corner of Christianity, they've become important things? Is that what I'm really boasting in, like the Judaizers teach, or is it something else? Is it something else that I should make my boast or make my brag? Am I glorying in the fact that even the things that I do, that I read my Bible a lot, or that I soul win a lot, or that I dress the right way, or that I worship in the right kind of church, or that I worship in the exact preferential way that I think is more spiritual, or whatever. What is it that I am proud of? What is it that I stand or boast on as a Christian? What is it that I lift up, that I take my stock in? We definitely, folks, boast and rejoice in something else other than what we can do in our body. We glory only in the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. And what happened there on that old rugged cross 2,000 years ago is everything to us. It is our complete standing on this earth. It is our standing with God. It is our position. It is our joy. It is our glory. It is our brag. It is our boast. Not anything that I could tell you about what a good pastor I am, or a good Christian I am, or that I do this, or that I'm wearing a tie tonight. No, I will glory in the cross. That is our joy. Think about what the Lord Jesus did for us. Think about that. Think about that being your standing and all you need, your sufficiency. You're accepted in the Beloved. You are free from your sin. You have a place reserved in heaven for you. Eternally, you will sing and put angels to shame. You have come to the cross. What happened there is our glory, is our joy. It reminds me, and I think I understand a little bit more from this passage, what Paul was talking about in Philippians 3 and verse number 8, where he lists his pedigree and all the things that he had done. I mean, a Pharisee of Pharisees and all these things, I can't remember all of them, that he lists about everything that man would glory in, that would make a biography that would see, people would say, wow, what a godly man this is. And he says at the end of this, and all these things that were gained unto me, them I counted loss. I counted dung for the excellency of the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. There is nothing for us to boast in that we could ever do externally in our flesh, that we could brag about, that we could make a show in the flesh. It simply comes down to Christ and what he did for us on that cross. He is enough. And more than that, he's more than enough. He is, I've been using the word extravagant 500 times, I'll use it again. He's extravagantly enough for you in this life and the next. And so you better start, like Paul, boasting in him. You better start bragging about what Jesus has done in your life. You can stand on him and not your own performance, Paul says, and not adding this and being circumcised and keeping this and dressing this way and doing this 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 and glorying in that you have done enough. No, Christ did enough. He said it's finished. He did enough. Listen, we have no confidence or glorying in the things that we do in our bodies to save ourselves or externals to show our spirituality. It is all about the Savior who died on the cross to both reconcile us to God and to put us in right standing forever as children of God. Following him in sanctification is exactly that, following him and becoming more like him and putting on the fruit of the Spirit, which is another way of saying following Jesus Christ. Like the seven things this morning, we are following that Christ to grow as well, and that is tethered to what he has done for us on the cross. Not making a fair show in the body. I feel good about my relationship to God because of only the cross. That's enough to get Pentecostal about. That's enough. You could feel good about your position and your standing with Christ because of what he did on the cross to save you, and that you are following him with your life and obeying him, coming after him. That is enough. I will fail, but that cross will never fail for me. The verses lay out here as we go into 14 and 15, two reasons I glory only in the cross of Christ and his work. Verse 14, because the world is crucified to me, and I to it in Jesus' cross. Look what it says. But God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. I think this is as what he's saying here about what happened on the cross, crucified the world to me, and I to the world, I think has two clear meanings. The first, the very obvious meaning, and then something that has to do with these Judaizers. What's the first one? Paul says, when I believed on Jesus' cross, that did something in my life that mere external religion could never do. all the world had to offer that I once chased after with the desires of my body, all that died to me on the cross. The world was crucified to me and I to it on the cross of Jesus. Folks, living external religion. You know, do you remember this? This keeps coming to my mind. I think the Holy Spirit wants me to share it. Do you remember how you can tell a false teacher from a true teacher? It's the fruits of his life. You know, living external things can never crucify the world to you or you to the world. But when a man is born again, when he's been to the cross and he trusts on that Christ hanging on that cross, the world becomes dead to him. It loses his power. It becomes dead to her. She doesn't want to live that way anymore. She pursues dying to self. It's a whole real game now. It's real. False teachers just live in the externals. False Christians just live in the externals. But truly coming into the cross, the world dies to you and you to the world. Those things, you don't want those things anymore. They may temporarily satisfy your flesh. You may fall to them once in a while. You don't want to live to them. I'll tell you, when I got a good glimpse of the beauty of the Lord God, I don't want the stuff this world has to offer anymore. There is nothing in all the world so beautiful as far as the temptation of sin that compares in one little drop to the beauty and the glory of God Almighty. So Paul says, the world is crucified to me. That's why I'm going to glory. I'm going to brag in the cross because it turned the world off to me. But I think he may be alluding to something else about these Judaizers. I think he may also be saying that that world of trying to perform and that world of living for externals, I mean, he lived all his life for that as a Pharisee. That world was crucified to me up on that cross too. I don't take any, it's all manure now, he says, Philippians 3. It's all dung to me. That whole thought of being good enough to be saved, being good enough to please God and sanctify, it's all just dung to me. It's crucified to me and I to it. He says there's a second reason I brag about the cross. I only glory in the cross because Jesus' cross made me into a new creature. That's the last phrase of verse number 15. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision availeth anything nor uncircumcision, but a new creature. It doesn't matter that this mosaic thing that I got circumcised or that I'm not circumcised, that's just all external stuff that has no bearing. What matters is that one day by faith in the cross, the Holy Spirit of God came into my heart and made me born again. That's what really matters. I'm a brand new creature now. I was born into the family of God. And that can only happen, and that's what I'm bragging about, because I've been to the cross. External things can never make a person born again. In fact, that only brings great frustration. Do we get Paul's point here? You can come to this Baptist church and do all the external things that others will look at and think, oh, she's a mighty nice Christian, a mighty good Christian, but that ain't worth a hill of beans. Because that outward practice cannot make you born again. If you're trusting in that hill of beans, you're not trusting in much. If you're trusting in the externals of doing all the right stuff, you ain't trusting in anything. That's all worthless and cannot make you born again. But you should glory, you must glory in the cross of Jesus Christ that makes you a new creature. Not circumcision, not perfect church attendance, not doing all the right Christian things, only what Jesus did on the cross. And I also grow in my sanctification because of what Jesus did on the cross. That's what you feel good about. That's what you brag about concerning your Christianity. That's what you think about and you get excited about, that cross, what Jesus did, not the piece of wood, what Jesus did, the spiritual meaning, what Christ did, and he died for you, and what that finishing that he did for you. That is where you enjoy God's mercy and his peace. You've been to that cross and trusted what Jesus did to there. You are saved and growing in Jesus, following him. It's all because of Jesus and what he did, period. Glory in it. Absolute gospel. Rejoice in it. Know that you're accepted by God because of it, not externals. Live the simplicity of being to the cross and following Jesus Christ with your life. Live that absolute, pure simplicity of the gospel. The third point is very short. It's verse 16. The blessing that comes when you make Christ's cross your boast. So verse 14 and 15, Paul says, I'm only going to boast in one thing, and that's the cross. That's going to be my standing place. That's going to be my excitement. That's going to be the focus of my life, my Christian life. In verse 16, he gives you kind of a blessing. He says, and as many as walk according to this rule, if you will live your Christian life that way, peace be on them and mercy and upon the Israel of God. He's actually telling you what will come to your life if you focus on and boast in the cross of Jesus Christ are these two things, you know, mercy and peace we be upon you. It's God's blessing upon your life, a wonderful way to live. Living by externals is horrible. Living by the cross and Christ is wonderful. He makes one more jab at these Judaizers. The end of verse number 16, and upon the Israel of God. They said, you want to truly be accepted by God and in the family of God, you got to put on this law. He says, no, no, no. If you glory in the cross, you are the true Israel of God. You are the true people of God, those who have been to the cross and those who refuse adding anything to the pure message of the cross. The closing comments of the book go like this, verse 17. From henceforth, let no man trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. What did he mean by this? What are the marks? It's persecution. He says, what does he mean? Don't trouble me anymore because I bear the marks, the scars of our Lord Jesus Christ. He is saying, it's connected to this Judaizing thing again, these externals. He is saying, put this adding of the law and this external religion question to rest. Don't bring it up to me anymore. Settle it. Understand where I stand on it. Cling to Christ alone. It should be obvious to you that I have preached about this and that I have stood on this all my time because for the absolute gospel, for standing for Christ alone and not the law and not externals, I've been beaten and I've been stoned and I've been shipwrecked and I've been in prison and I've been persecuted in every town I go in. Why? Because I stand for Jesus Christ alone. So see the marks on my back. See my busted skull when they stoned me. And no, I didn't get this by following the Mosaic law. I got this by following the cross. Because I opened my mouth and I preached Christ alone. So Paul is, that's a really nice way of Paul's scars saying, shut up about anything that can be added to the gospel. It is Christ and Christ alone. As we close this great book tonight, it is too our job to protect and preach Christ alone and to not give one inch or credence to any different gospel in our theology or in our practice around this church. Christ's cross is enough. We are not to elevate things and methods of the way that we do things to the level of Scripture or the level of sanctification. We're not to add soapboxes and externals or whatever other than what come directly out of this wonderful book, and specifically the New Testament. Christ's cross is enough. It is the absolute gospel. And the last verse really says it all about grace that comes through Christ. It says, brethren, the grace of keeping externals, of keeping the Mosaic law, of adding all these things. No, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Be with your spirit. And all God's people said, amen. The absolute gospel, Jesus Christ alone, no other way.